One of the big things I like to talk to people about is like, let's get you to move into action through something that's transformative. And so that's why I'm really excited to talk to you today because number one, you did this for yourself because you had rosacea for 20 years and you healed it within 4 months. And now you help people from all over the world and have helped people from all over the world do the same thing. Gotta stand up straight. Without further ado, Dr. Tara Odesky, I'm so excited to have you with me today. Can you introduce yourself, tell a little bit about your background, tell about your story, anything that you'd like to share to let people know who you are and what you were dealing with rosacea? This is your time to let people into your world.
It's fascinating because I never thought my life would take this turn to be sitting here with you talking about rosacea out, to the whole world, but I developed rosacea when I was about 25 and went to the dermatologist just like everyone does, got some topical antibiotics, some oral antibiotics. Oh, come back in 3 months. Of course, it's not gone. And then, year after year, it tends to get progressively worse. And so every year I'd go back to the dermatologist. Are there new medications? What am I supposed to be doing? I notice it flares when I eat certain foods, and they'd really be very dismissive about any sort of connection to food or anything. Well, it's not curable. You're going to deal with this the rest of your life. And I'd always leave and sit in my car and cry and say, like, how bad is this going to get? It becomes, over time, it can be actually deformative and disfiguring. And I would look at pictures of older people with, the bulbous noses and go, gosh, like, I'm only 25. What's it going to be like when I'm 45? And tried to kind of push it away. And eventually I got to the point after having 2 kids and going through like hormonal changes and having these massive flare-ups where my skin was just so purpley red to the point where I'd walk no matter where I went. If I went into a pizza shop, if I went into a Target, people would come up to me and say, are you okay? Do you need water? People thought I was having a heart attack 24/7. And I just posted this picture on my Instagram of me when I think it was around my 40th birthday, and just looking at my face, and this was after having put tons and tons of foundation on, and the color of my face is that purpley beet red, and it was chronically like that. And so, I'd have patients sitting in front of me, and I'm doing an exam on them, and they're saying to me, are you okay? Do you need water? And so, it got to the point I was like, gosh, like I've got to figure this out. I have got to figure this out. What is causing this? Why is my health deteriorating? I'm a healthy person. I know about nutrition. I know about amazing healthy supplements. Like how can I fix this? And I just started researching and researching. I really felt like it was connected to my gut because it had such poor gut health for so long. And when I noticed that when I would be really sick and I wouldn't eat for a few days, my skin would clear up. So I was like, okay, there, it's got to be connected somehow to that. I also started learning a lot about liver and how your liver can kind of build up toxins. And I'd had a ton of toxic exposures as a kid, like to smoke and then to formaldehyde and to dry cleaning chemicals. And these tend to pile up in your liver, especially if your gut is compromised. So your gut can't absorb the nutrients that your liver needs to detoxify. So it looking back, I was very much set up to develop rosacea. I just didn't know why. And so this research journey took me through the connection between skin and gut, and then the mind and the emotions. And I just started working relentlessly on, gut healing and liver detoxifying and spleen health and emotions. And I got to a point where I was pretty much rosacea free. After several months, I could go out with a friend and have a glass of wine and zero flare up, zero flushing. My skin completely changed texture as well. I had type 2 where you really have that like orange peel. You can, when you look at someone up close, you can see this like texture, and it's usually covered in bumps. It's like an acne rosacea. So all of that completely went away. I was so dumbfounded. I kept saying over and over to everyone, like, how is this possible? How did this go away? Everything I read says it's incurable. And yet, when you do all these things, it actually can go away. And I just felt the need to share this with anyone who was desperately trying to resolve their rosacea. And so I put it on a website and put it out to the universe. And people started contacting me, and here we are today. And I've built a program so that it walks people through these steps that you take. It gives them very specific guidance, because the whole dietary thing, people are so confused about. They're being told to avoid very specific foods that are actually very healing foods. So it becomes kind of this minefield of, what am I supposed to eat? I can't eat anything. I just won't eat anything. And so anyway, here we are, and I'm very happy to continue to share this knowledge with people.
How long ago was that, that you had that 4-month journey and were like, it's working?
So it started December 2019. I think that was kind of like the downfall. I was at work, and one of the aides, the medical aides, came up to me and kind of like screamed, like, what's wrong with your face? And this is in a waiting room full of patients. And I was horrified, because I was like, how am I supposed to go to work and present myself at work, and people are looking up to me to help them, when clearly there's something wrong here? That was it. I was like, I'm done. I will not let this go. And every night I would stay up till 3 a.m, just reading PubMed, like research, what is this connection? And then, you know, starting early 2020 was when I started to see changes, especially to my gut health, where I wasn't waking up with a stomach ache every day. And come to find out, I had celiac. I only found out I had celiac 4 months ago. So it turns out I had it my entire life and never knew. So that was a big part of the puzzle for me, was when I actually eliminated gluten and realized that my gut could start to heal. And so that was the first amount of progress I saw. But I had so much mercury toxicity and heavy metal toxicity that the gluten alone would never have healed rosacea. There were other things that I had to do to actively remove these things.
How did you find out about, because I've heard, I think maybe you said this in our previous interview as well, that you had some testing done and it was coming back saying that you were fine. You didn't have allergens. How are you able to find out about the toxicity that was happening inside of your body? And it seems like recently finding out about celiac.
Yeah. So I'd had blood work done about 10 years ago, and they did celiac testing and they said, it's fine. You know, you don't have to do a biopsy. Everything's fine. And then of course, when I did it 4 months ago, they were like, well, it's unlikely, but let's just do the biopsy just in case. And of course, when they did the biopsy, they said, oh, you absolutely have celiac. So that was a shocker. And I'm really, you know, after several years of doing this with people, I'm not a fan of testing, because so many times the testing is not accurate. So people will, and then I also did like food allergy testing with Everlywell, which is like a panel, and they test your blood and came back like nothing. You're not allergic to anything. So I was like, all right, well, there's that. And then the heavy metals was not a test. Now there are tests you can do. There's like hair strand testing you can do. But again, I've met with people who did the testing and said, oh, it's not heavy metals, it's not mercury, I did testing. And when we put them on a specific cleanse for mercury or for heavy metals, they get better. So I've seen it too often. So I no longer rely on testing. I don't do testing. I don't like testing. I go by symptoms. And having had so many silver fillings or amalgams since I was like 7 years old, I knew that mercury was going to be an issue for me. So throw away the testing. Everything I do now is based on symptoms.
Yeah, I completely forgot. I've been hearing a lot recently about those metal fillings and I have a crown that couldn't withhold from whatever they build around it. So they actually had to put a metal stud in it. And so now I'm starting to hear things about that. I'm like, oh, yeah. Great. My mouth is filled.
Yeah. Well, yeah. You want to know what type of metal is that stud. And for people who have metal fillings, I would highly recommend going to a holistic dentist and having them safely removed. There's a method that they'll use called the SMART method that will remove it so that you're not inhaling the mercury vapors. And that can be really life-changing for many people. They see a difference right away.
Why do you think so many dermatologists, and maybe it's because they're skin doctors and experts, but why do you think so many of them, I hear from people who have rosacea that say, that there's no cure for this, or they're trying to put me on medications and it might get better for a little bit and then it doesn't get better and then they put me on something else. Do you think it's just the lack of knowledge and outside of their expertise, or have you ever heard of dermatologists recommending people to specialists who can talk about gut health?
No, I think it's what they're being taught in medical school. It's not their fault. It takes 17 years for current research to actually make it into practice. So what they're learning in medical school is this poor person has this terrible skin redness. We can help them by giving them this antibiotic. That's what they're being taught. Here's your disease. Here's your medication. It's very rare for traditional medical schools to dive into the why and the underlying factors, and naturopathic doctors, any sort of functional medicine doctor, chiropractors, they have a ton of education in that field of let's not put a bandaid on it. Let's figure out what's going on internally to cause it. And so I don't think it's the dermatologist's fault at all. I just think they're not educated in that. And, you know, they have a lot of drug reps coming in and talking about new medications. And that's kind of where they are. And then if someone asks about diet, they're like, I don't really know, you know, maybe you should ask a dietitian. Like it's just not something that they're educated in and something that they're comfortable even talking about.
It kind of cuts off at that. Yeah. If we're going to go beyond the surface, they're literally trained to look at the surface, look at the skin right under the skin and go off of the education that they've been provided with. Yeah. So that, I guess that would make sense. But I just hear so many people that they go see a dermatologist, even with flushing and blushing. Sometimes people go and they get diagnosed with rosacea and they have flare-ups with anxious situations. And I know that you had shared in the past that even for you with rosacea, if there was an anxious moment going on, that it would flare up and have that similar flush or blush appearance.
Absolutely. That would happen all, even with my baseline redness, if I ate certain foods or if I had to speak in public or if I was having a talk with someone and I was starting to feel anxious, I would immediately go into fire engine red. And then the person is like, well, what's going on here? Are you okay? You know, then we go through the whole, do you need to sit down issue? And yeah, and many people with rosacea will have that emotional flare up as well as especially reactions to alcohol or certain foods or sunlight, or there's a whole list of things they'll react to.
That's very similar to what I was experiencing with flushing. And some people that I hear that have a lot of the facial blushing is that they would say that the sun would create a reaction. Anxious moments really create the reaction. Do you, for you in particular, you've mentioned a few times, like people calling it out and saying things about it, which is a huge thing in the blushing Phoenix community. And how people usually wind up finding me is that they have a moment where they're tired of people calling it out. How for you in your career at that time and just being able to continue to show up or speak, what was your driving force, or how did you continue to put yourself out in the public eye knowing that people were going to say something and like the emotional impact that that can have on somebody? How did you handle those things?
I think in a way, I'm kind of glad that this happened when I was in my mid 40s, because I think if I was 25 and this was happening, it would have completely shut me down. But having two kids and needing a paycheck and needing to keep up with life, and at that point, my focus was not on myself, it was on my kids and what, you know, providing for them and being a great mom. So luckily, I was out of that stage of life where you're really hyper-focused on your appearance. And like, you know, that's kind of like your 20, but then it's like everything changes, right? You have kids and then that becomes your world. So as much as I needed to be professional and show up at work, I was going to go to work no matter what. And if people said something, they said something. I needed to show up and be there, but I was dead set on, I'm going to figure this out. Like, I will not let this go. Dermatologists have never helped me. This is not a skin issue. This is something else. And I will figure this out.
Yeah. I think it's funny because I'm 38. So I have kind of gone through, and I didn't start having flushing happening to me until around 2017. So I was right at the beginning of starting to advance in my career. And that's actually when it started getting really bad for me, because I think I was so much closer to those authoritative leadership elements, and I needed to be perceived a certain way in my world, I thought, in order to be able to continue to gradually climb that ladder. And it felt like, oh my gosh, they're gonna think I'm incompetent and that I won't be able to do any, I'm lacking confidence. So that's when I started to really hide. And I've seen people who, when I have talked to women, especially that are either in their 40s or in their 50s, there is another doctor that I talked to. Her name is Dr. Madeline, and I believe she's in Brussels. She did a TEDx talk about blushing, how she overcame her blushing, and she's in her 50s. And it's so interesting to hear just from the different spectrums of ages, because she is in that space now of she's done the career thing. She's doing her own thing now. And she said she realized that when her blushing stopped was when she was in like a group setting, at like doing a project of some sort. And she thought about the team and how she could help the team, and her focus got off of herself. And yeah. I've realized even for myself over the past couple of years, I can be in a room with people and I'm like, whoa, I was actually listening to them. I wasn't just focused on like me, you know, right. That kind of cycle of like, what's happening with me and what are people thinking about right. me? And they're literally not thinking about you because they're so busy thinking about themselves that the last thing anybody's doing is thinking about you. And I think for younger people, I just talked to somebody the other day who's in his early 20s. And I'm going to interview him in the near future. And I think he's going to be able to really talk to such a group that I can't always talk to, because it didn't happen in my adolescence. Right. And I can't even imagine, especially with social media.
The 20-year-olds coming up today and the, you know, early 30-year-olds, I feel terrible for them because I didn't live that. I mean, I was 20, almost 30 years ago, and there was no internet, I don't even think. You know, you were face to face with people and they could comment, but you weren't comparing yourself on social media. You weren't brushing up your appearance. Like, I feel so bad. Look, you scroll through Instagram and nobody's real. Like, these faces, none of it's real. It's all touched up. And having to compare yourself to that, I cannot even imagine with, a 20 something who is trying to fit in, trying to find their career path, wanting to show up and look good, and then worrying about, am I going to turn red? Am I going to flush? Is my skin going to be breaking out? It's just, it's very stressful. And I feel terrible for people going through that.
Do you have, for people who reach out to you, is there like a broad range of ages? Is it male and female? Is it like, what's the who normally is reaching out to you?
It's interesting because the typical age of onset is getting much lower now. When I was diagnosed at 25, the dermatologist said I was the youngest patient she'd ever had with rosacea. And the typical age then was in the late 40s. So now we're seeing it. I mean, the majority of people that I see are probably in their 20s. I've had teens who've developed it, 14, 15-year-olds, who've had amazing success in reversing it early on, which is fantastic. But I just think that as we're exposed to more and more toxins in our environment, in our food, in our water, in our air, it's no surprise that people cannot detoxify the way they did even 20 years ago, because everyone's eating fast food, and you know, then you go back to gut health, and everyone's very anxious these days. Like, look at the teens and all the anxiety and depression, and a lot of it is social media, but unfortunately, I feel like a lot of these health conditions in general are coming on much, much earlier than we were seeing 20 years ago.
Yeah. And do you find that these people are showing up at your doorstep, so to speak, in from the physical appearance? Are they having pain? What are typical symptoms for somebody with rosacea that kind of gets them to that breaking point of being like, I've got to get help from somewhere else besides the dermatologist?
Because it's progressive, if you let it go long enough, it does become pain. I was definitely in that state where I would be in pain when I would have a full-on flush. It becomes neurogenic and you actually are in pain. And so that the longer that progresses, the harder that is to reverse. It can reverse, but it just takes longer. And I'm seeing a lot of people with ocular rosacea. That's also kind of a subtype, but it's something you develop. So I had ocular rosacea. I didn't know. I would always go to the eye doctor. My eyes are so dry. my eyes were red and itchy when I wake up? Is it my contacts? And they would just give me rewetting drops. That's all I ever got. And it turns out it was ocular rosacea, which is intertwined with facial rosacea in many cases, and also can be reversed. But people just don't know this, are not aware of this, are not being told this. And there's just so much that can be done for these people.
Do when we have the redness on the face, not the below the surface stuff in the gut health, but just on the surface, is that just dilation of blood vessels? What's actually happening that's creating the redness?
Yeah, that's blood rushing into your face, into your neck and chest often. And so it's almost like a sensitive or an allergic reaction almost that, now that's like when you experience, an emotion or food or something. If you're chronically red, yes, that's also from just these, overworked or overused. It's a vascular thing. And for people with rosacea, you often see broken blood vessels because those blood vessels have been, extended and almost like swollen or enlarged for so long that they eventually burst.
Yeah. And I've seen, so when I heard some of your story and you were talking about where you started in diet, you realized that it was something that's going to be below the surface. It's not going to be skin. This is not working. What was your kind of first step in, because when you talk about it from a high level view, it's like, okay, we've got some liver stuff, we've got some gluten stuff. What was your first step of going, let me try this out? And how was it when you started to realize like this is working? And how soon did you realize it was working?
I think the first thing I did was no gluten, no dairy, because I had just been reading so much about gut health and that those can be so inflammatory to people. Now, meanwhile, I'm thinking I don't have celiac, and I had previously tried eliminating gluten and nothing had changed, but I had only eliminated it for like a week or two. And then I was like, this is too hard and it's not working. But it's interesting because gluten is one of those things. It's actually the only food that cannot be broken down fully. So it ends up staying in your gut almost like plastic and just going round and round and round while your gut is desperately trying to break it down. So they feel like gluten can stay in your body for about 7 to 10 days after you've consumed it. It can get into your brain. It can do all sorts of things, even for people who are not sensitive to gluten. So doing them together, the dairy and the gluten, really started to have less flare-ups and I started to have less bumps. And I was like, okay, like this actually I might be onto something. And then continued, you know, like what else is going on? What can I do to actually heal your gut? A lot of people focus on gut healing, but if you're actively trying to heal your gut, now I had tried like supplements, like gut healing supplements that did absolutely nothing because I was still eating inflammatory foods. So the supplements weren't being broken down, weren't being absorbed. So when you kind of put it all together, a combination of eliminating the right foods and then including the right foods, and you do that for a solid month, that's when people start to see progress. And then you really have to start doing that inner work that we kind of talked about. So much of this is emotional. You've got to dig deep and kind of figure out what else is going on. You know, what are you holding on to? What are you angry about? There's a lot there. And for some people, that is a much bigger thing than the dietary part of it. So yeah. So there's like a whole bucket of stuff that will eventually cause rosacea, and it's different for everyone, but usually doing one thing like eliminating gluten can possibly get you started, but it's not going to be the end all.
When people come to you and they are like, help me. What do you offer to them? Courses, workshops, one-on-one? What does that look like? What do you have to offer?
So I did do one-on-ones for a long time. I think in like 2021, I started doing those and they were great for people. But what I soon realized was that I didn't want to just tell people what to do. I wanted them to understand what was going on, because after a month, they would come running back and say, okay, well, now I'm reading this label and I don't know if I can buy this or not. And what should I do next? And I realized that it would be much more helpful to actually educate them, which I couldn't do in an hour. So I put together a whole bunch of videos and, you know, almost like classwork so that people could begin to be educated on their gut and liver so that when they go to the grocery store, they know what they're doing. They know what to choose. They're not having to reach out. And so I feel like the course has actually been much more effective than the one-on-ones, because I was kind of telling people the same thing over and over and realizing that it would be like, could help more people if it was put together in a program. And so I no longer do one-on-ones for that reason. And I've just continued to add to the course so that so many, as more things come up, such as parasites and lymphatic system and all these other issues that a lot of people with rosacea are also dealing with, that they can get help for that as well.
That's incredible. And do people through the course, are they able to get like a dietary plan to get them started? Or is that something that has to be more custom as they go on? Or do you just see very similar results across the board?
Yeah. So when you join the program, it's a 6-week program, but we do a 1-month cleanse protocol. So everyone is typically following the same cleanse protocol. They may need some guidance from their own doctor, because I am not able to give a specific guidance to anyone, because it's an individual educational program, but the bones are there so that they can read that and do what they will and follow it. And at the end of the month, they kind of have a decision of like, what was most helpful? What am I going to do forever? I mean, personally, I will forever be taking a probiotic every day, because I realize how amazingly beneficial it is in so many ways. Cause I'm not eating an extremely diverse diet. I try to, but you know, I'm barely home. So, you know, there are certain things that I'll always do. And most people after that month will come back and say, wow, like, this is amazing. I no longer have gas and bloating. I'm no longer constipated. This is amazing. And then they want to do continue certain elements of it. And that's when they can then start to focus on things like spleen and things like heavy metals and all other things that are going on with them. So then we talk about all that in the future modules.
Awesome. So for the probiotics, what I know, there's a lot, I hear a lot of controversy around probiotics. From your perspective, what is the most effective probiotic? What are people looking for when they are trying to find a really good probiotic?
Okay, so the problem with probiotics is that if you have something like SIBO and you've heard, oh, I'm supposed to take probiotics, and you go and take a probiotic, there's a chance that that probiotic could actually make your symptoms a lot worse, because SIBO is small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. So you actually have an overgrowth of bacteria, and now you're going to give yourself a probiotic, which is going to add more bacteria to that. So it's again, like this minefield, like people will hear chatter, oh, you should take a probiotic, and they'll go to Target and buy the number one selling probiotic on the market. And they'll take it, and they don't know if it's working or not, but they're just going to take it because they think they should. So we don't use that probiotic. We have a very specific probiotic that's a soil-based probiotic that is effective whether or not you have SIBO, no matter what kind of gut issue. And that's the beginning of the probiotic. So like you would do that initially, and then you would focus on gut healing. And, you know, maybe a few months down the line, when your gut can tolerate more, that's when you would start to introduce some more strains that will not cause a terrible reaction if you were to have SIBO.
You're kind of getting to a baseline. And so, right. So you're kind of getting your body to a baseline to be able to even start to figure out if you're feeling good and things are looking good, and you take something and you start getting these flare-ups again, then you will know exactly. But it's similar to elimination diet, and then you're starting to add things back in.
Right. Exactly. Very similar. Yeah. But I do feel like, you know, a lot of people come in and they say, I don't eat anything. I did this diet. I did this diet. They did 3 or 4 diets previously to coming to me, and they're only eating like lettuce and, I don't know, rice. And they're just terrified of food because everything they eat gives them a flare up. And so food fear is a major problem. And so when most people do my program, they're like, oh my God, this is amazing. I can eat so many foods that I thought I couldn't eat. So that's been great for people to realize that you don't have to be afraid of spices and colorful foods, and they're amazing foods. And you just have to, you know, be able to know which ones you can start to include.
And I think it's the little joys from food that we forget about, because even for like personally recovering from COVID, I lost my taste and smell. It's been gone for quite a few days now. And it's like, the world is so gray when you cannot taste or smell or enjoy foods. So.
Yeah, I know, we love food. We love social interactions with food and sitting with a friend and having dessert. And my whole program is not about living in a restrictive state. It's about healing so that you can have coffee and you can have cake with your friend, and you can, you know, unless of course you're like me and you have celiac, but aside from gluten, I pretty much eat every other thing out there. I go out with friends, I can drink alcohol, and I can live a normal life now because I've healed. So it's absolutely possible for anyone. I don't want anyone to ever think like you can heal, but then you're going to live in misery because you can't ever enjoy your life. It's not like that at all.
That's what I think a lot of people think when they hear about gut health. We got to like clean up the gut. We got to heal the gut. Is that you're going to eliminate everything and now your life's just going to be bland. You can't have any of the things. In our last interview, and I was like, what about wine? I was like, immediately. And I think I had talked too about how there were other factors like coffee, wine, alcohol. There were things and like not optimizing my sleep. And when I was listening back to our interview, I was just cracking up. So I'm like, my life has changed so much since that conversation. And the little things like getting adequate sleep, getting healthy sleep can really transform. I think that that helped a lot with some of the flushing that I was dealing with as well. It was so deeply rooted in a psychological space of like this program that was playing over and over again. But there were things that absolutely contribute to it as well, which is like poor diet, lots of caffeine, way too much caffeine, the way you should be taking in, alcohol, lack of sleep, things that just help trigger those flushes that are not helping.
And we've all gone through that. I mean, I think every busy mom has this year or at least of their life where they're just functioning. They're just getting through the days. Like, you know, you can't go to sleep without wine and you can't wake up without coffee, and God help you if you have to get rid of them. Like, but, and I hear that all the time. And then the idea of removing it is terrifying because you know that you're going to be miserable for a week without your coffee. So it's hard to kind of commit to that. But then if you realize like it is very temporary, it's very temporary, and so much can heal in a month. And even my sister, for example, had insomnia for years and years and years. And I finally got her to do my cleanse month, and she was resisting it. And what does this have to do with insomnia? But she was at like a complete breaking point and she did it. And what do you know? Like she sleeps like a baby. So, you know, you can heal years and years and years worth of trauma and abuse in a month. You really can. And you just, you know, and then you learn so much and then you just make better choices.
That's something that I've learned on my own journey is that, you know, it's taken about 6 years, but once I started to get it, it was like drastic changes were happening overnight. It was so wild how I remember getting on Blushing Phoenix at one point and just being like, I don't know that there's ever going to be a cure for this. And I'm not even going to focus on a cure anymore because I was so tired of the up and down of like, oh, I made progress. Oh no, we're back where we started. Oh, I made progress. We're back where we started. So I started thinking about how am I going to live anyway? Like, how am I going to continue on with my life? And I didn't realize that just by taking my focus off of it was healing me. Right. From you know, from what I was dealing with. And when I think about the similarities with rosacea and the things that I was going through, or people from Blushing Phoenix are going through, they are so similar. And that if people aren't addressing some of the underlying issues, whether that's the psychological, emotional elements, or your body, I love that from the work that you do, it's a holistic approach of looking at the person as a full individual and addressing all the different areas. With healing, one of the big things I've been talking about recently is just reminding people that healing takes time, that not to feel so distraught if you just don't feel like you're making progress. And I think that's because this journey can be very isolating and people think that, well, you know, you healed in 4 months. That's miraculous. I'm not healing in 4 months. Your program is 6 weeks. What would you say to people about when they can expect to see? I know that it's not everybody's going to be different, but from your clients that have come through the program, what's typical to see for healing?
The first thing I say to them is at the end of the 6 weeks, you are not going to be healed. You may have healed a little bit. You may be starting the process of healing, but I mean, if you were this like boulder that had come to a grinding halt and we have to actually get the boulder moving again, it's going to take 6 weeks, you know, 10 weeks, 3 months, before we start move in the other direction if you've been going in the wrong direction for so long. So I typically see a lot of progress in 3 to 4 months. That's a really good place for a lot of people, is consistency for 3 to 4 months and seeing major changes. We've had a lot of people in the first month, it's not realistic, but who can find a food sensitivity that they didn't know they had. And it's very clear. And so in that case for them, there's significant healing right away. And then we have people who have been in touch with me for a year and a half, and have done a lot of inner work. A lot of people like removing breast implants, like doing things that you can't do right away. Getting a divorce, moving, changing their life entirely, focusing on the things that I've talked about, and coming back a year later and saying, look at me, like I've healed. So if you can go in without a timeline, that is your best bet. And like you said, you really want to focus on not, I want the outcome to be a better appearance. You want the outcome to be a healed person, like an inner healing. And then the reflection of that is going to be your rosacea or your blushing going away, but you've got to be healed inside first.
I love that. I wanted to ask you a question from your chiropractic side of things, because I recently here in South Carolina started going to, I fell off of our stairs. I missed a bottom step and I fell. And, at this age, which in my mind, I'm still 19, but right. At this age, when you take a fall, it is like, I was just so impressed with myself that I didn't die or like break ribs. It felt like I've never broken ribs, but it felt like what I would imagine broken ribs feel like. And I fell on like my side like this. So I kind of caught myself and went to the chiropractor. They did x-rays and they're fantastic. But he's like, holy, have you ever seen your body before? And I'm like, not in a long time. He's like, your body, you're literally going like this. And it's from a fall. It's from like years of like your spine. So anyway, he's like, we won't get you back to 100%, but we will get you really, really good. And you won't have like pain or anything like that. And luckily I didn't have any that he could see major issues from the fall. He was shocked. He's like, the fall like that is like being in a car accident. So you're really lucky that you took that fall the way you did. Yeah. And the only thing we saw was like my jaw was off just a little bit. So
okay.
I saw that. But I actually was flushing. This was just about a month ago. I was flushing while I was in there because it was an environment that I had never been in before. It was really busy. It was small. I get a little triggered anyway when I know somebody's going to touch me, and like that's just like that, just that vulnerable state of being touched. Yeah. And but I was waiting for the chiropractor and their air was out and it was like 90 degrees or something. So it was like not the best first impression. Anyway, he was fantastic. And I was flushing when he came in and I was like just showing it to him and telling him about it. So he wasn't alarmed.
Right.
You know, he just looked at me like he couldn't care less. And no big deal, not a big deal at all. Anyway, I was talking to him afterwards and there's two, they're partners there. And I said, have you seen this before? And he's like, no, I mean, sometimes when we do neck adjustments, we might see something like that. Is that something that you've seen are you still in chiropractic practice?
Yes.
Is that something that you see with people flushing, blushing when they're getting adjusted?
Yeah, I actually see it a lot, especially if it's your first neck adjustment and your neck has never been adjusted before. We see it a lot. It's kind of for a lot of people, sometimes they'll have an immediate release of sinuses. Like their nose will start running right away. We see that, a lot of people cry, like they have an immediate emotional response. When you work on that level, there's so much intertwined there. There's a lot of vascular issues going on and neurological things and connections and the base of your skull and the top of your neck. When you manipulate that area, it's a major release. And so even like with babies with colic or, with children, they respond so quickly and their immediate reaction, I love, because it's, you never know what to expect. Like some people scream, some people cry, some people, and then, it, you know, with children, it's like, they'll come back a week later and be like, oh, you know, they're sleeping now, or, oh, you know, what do you know? They're no longer having this reaction. And so it's pretty powerful. Yeah. I love seeing that.
It's been a while since I worked with a functional neurologist in Tennessee, and, I I think that just being with him for so long, and we hadn't really looked at my body in quite some time. And then I fell and I came to these new chiropractors, which I was really nervous about because it's like, it's such a big deal. You know, they're like manipulating your spine.
Yeah.
But they have a traction bed. I'd never been on a traction bed before. And I cry on a traction bed. I cry with acupuncture. I cry after adjustment sometimes, just because I just feel that, not because it hurts at all. It's not because it right. hurts. It's a release, right? So
yeah.
I was asking one of them, and I'm curious to hear, especially since we're recording this, when I think about where I have been in a very kind of disconnected space between head and body. Mm. And I heard somebody talking recently about like vagus nerve. I haven't done a lot of research on vagus nerve, but she was talking about how we kind of just cut it off here. We cut everything off here so that we can look a certain way, be a certain way, smile, right. be friendly, and we shove everything back down into right. the body. And so recently I was thinking about, well, that's really interesting for if we're cutting our emotions off and we're shoving the voice down and we're getting all that stuff down back in the body, that the body would start to turn red because it's trying to say right. something. That's just my theory. What are your thoughts on that?
I've never heard that. I think that's fascinating. There's so many connections that we know nothing about, right? I mean, even now in this time, learning about the connection between gut and skin and brain and this access, the gut, skin, brain access, and how it all, it's fascinating because nobody has really done this research before. And so I totally believe you're onto something there, that, you know, our emotions are one thing and we're constantly having to have this outward appearance of everything's fine. And meanwhile, inside you're like freaking out or having anxiety and you have to appear like everything is totally normal, and we're conditioned to be like that. And so where does it go? Where does the emotion go if you can't express the emotion? So you're going to bury it. And in Chinese medicine, you bury emotions in organs. And so the liver is anger. And like there's like a chart. And I always thought it was fascinating because I'd always look up rosacea and liver and it would always say anger. And I would always say, I'm not angry. It's not anger. I don't know what it is. And then when I really started to think, okay, what if it is? What if there's a connection? That's when you really start to heal and you really start to address those things. So yeah, you're right on that.
Oh, I love hearing about this. I'm so fascinated by it. When we moved here to South Carolina, the first thing, there were two things I wanted to do first. One was I wanted to get my nose pierced because my daughter was about to turn 16 and she wanted to get her nose pierced. And I was like, you know what? I had my nose pierced at 18. And because I wanted to go into corporate America, I went to this job over and over and over again to try to get a job. And on like the fourth attempt, the office manager told me, if you take your nose ring out, we will hire you. So I took my nose ring out, and it was like the first act, because that was back in the day, you know, it wasn't.
Yeah.
So it was the first act of trading out something that I really right. loved as an expressive thing
right.
For a job. And so, and then the other thing I wanted to do was I wanted to get, I have like random tattoos that are just like at random on my body that yep. kind of are telling a story. And one of the things that I wanted to get on me was, this is the, it's three chakras. It
oh,
is the
I love face, that.
It is the throat, and it's the third eye for intuition. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of some of the lessons or things that I took from Tennessee with me that I was entering into South Carolina with, knowing that I'm safe and that I belong. Knowing right. that I have a voice and I can trust that voice, and I can speak when it's time to speak, even if it's scary right. and that I can really trust my intuition, because that was something that I feel like I shut down for many years because people didn't understand it. And I was looking for validation in the outside world
right.
of like,
right.
so I find it interesting. I love chiropractic care. I love functional neurology. I love all of those things. But when you were talking about like, even with the a neck adjustment, it's such a release. And that's just something I've really been focusing on over the past few months, of just the throat area and any sort of release in the body. I've been looking more into somatics and things that are, you know, letting your body weep, in the sense right. of feeling right. where is the pain. Right. And I think it's so interesting just finding that combination between when we're looking at flushing and redness, and we're going straight for the surface. Like, it's right here. It's right here. And we're like, I've got this redness relief. This is like a product review I was doing, where I was like, basically, I haven't even done, I was going to do a TikTok on it where I'm like, It doesn't work.
Yeah, you're missing the boat. You're missing the boat. It's everything.
It'll help cover some blemishes or like help makeup, but it's not going to do what you want it to do. Like there is no product out there that I know of right now that's going to do it. No, you got to get to the core. So what are you working on now? What do you plan to do in the future? What are you studying, listening to? Like what's going on in Dr. Tara's world?
So I mentioned parasites. I'm adding a parasite, module to my course because when I was in France in the spring, my daughter was doing a semester there. And so I went to visit her for a long weekend and I came back so sick, couldn't figure out what was wrong. Took several weeks and about 10 doctor's visits to find out, number one, I had celiac, which of course, thank goodness for this. And number two, I had a parasite and I was like, oh my gosh, like how does this happen? And so it was fascinating to me and, you know, antibiotics, parasites gone. Then I did a whole course of my own of, you know, gut healing and my own herbs for parasite. But I found it fascinating. And it turns out that like, number one, no one is testing this. I mean, I had to beg over and over and over for them to do a parasite test on me. And nobody wanted to do it. It was like, oh, you don't have a parasite. They swore to me I didn't have a parasite. And then when the test came back positive, she said, oh, in 10 years of practice, you're only the second person I've ever found with a parasite. I'm thinking that's because you don't test anyone. But parasites are a huge underlying cause of health issues and specifically rosacea. So not that your doctor is going to test you, especially if you don't have symptoms, but we're now thinking that about 50% of the population is walking around with active parasites and doesn't know it. So there's a lot of things you can do holistically. You don't need an antibiotic. A lot of these things you can do a specific protocol for parasites. So I'm going to be writing that and putting that in my course because I want people to be aware of the symptoms that they would be having and then how to address that themselves. And I'm just trying to get the word out there as always, because you know, Googling, like, I don't know if people can search for you and find you, but if you do a search for rosacea and natural healing, you can't find me. You find medication websites. So, anything we can do to get the word out, to get people the help they need when they're looking for holistic, ways of addressing this without just putting a medication on it.
Fantastic. Yeah. I think the only way people find me is if they know the term erythrophobia. That is like kind of the key word where people find me. When they usually message, they'll say, I just figured out there was a term for this. And that's how they find blushing fears pretty often. Or by hearing, when they're Googling certain things and they hear a message, usually with an interview, that they'll reach out and say, I thought I had this, but then now I'm thinking it's more of this. And that's what I love about being in community with you and Dr. Julie and Dr. Madeline and others that are in this space, because we're kind of hitting it from all angles.
right. I'm hoping it. And I see tons of rosacea people who share with me, you know, every time I'm in an anxious situation, I'm blushing and I'm like, go see Blushing Phoenix because you actually have erythrophobia and they've never heard of it. No, you know, it's not a word that you see often. And most people in the medical community have never even heard of it. So I'm so glad that you're bringing this to light. And I know you have two books, right? Two books. Mm-hmm. And you're all over YouTube and you're growing and you're only getting bigger and bigger because there's a need for this. There's a need for people like Dr. Julie to address this internally, and you to share with people, like, you don't have to live with this. There are actually things you can do. And that was my biggest thing, was I just wanted people to know that this is not a life sentence. There's so much you can do. You just don't know what to do. So we're going to tell you what to do.
Yeah. It's something about people paving a way. It just makes you feel so hopeful. I know when I years ago was struggling so deeply with depression, and I would go to a bookstore and I would just go to like the self-help area and find books of people who had overcome, because if I was like, if they can do it, I can do it. And that's what I love about your story about, you know, trying to do all the things to get the help and realizing like, this isn't good enough. This is not good enough. There's a better answer. There's gotta be a better answer. And you went and found it for yourself. And I'm so grateful for that. And I know this is going to be so helpful for people who listen into this. I will put all of your information in our description box like we always do. And I'll also link our previous interview from a couple of years ago Again, so funny listening to it for me in the parts that I'm sharing about myself, because you and I had just, that's when we met. So
right. I know, that was the first time we met. I know. And look how far we've both come.
I know, it's been great. 2 years. I've moved states. We're like, you know, growing and expanding. Yeah. It's always such a pleasure to talk to you. Thank you so much for being willing to just do what you're doing in the community and spend this time with me, so that we can get the word out to others who are looking for answers.
You're so welcome. And I love chatting with you, and I love sharing what you're doing as well, because you're doing amazing work. So don't give up. I won't give up. We'll keep going and we'll spread the word.
Hey friend, technically this is the end of the video, but Dr. Tara and I had a little bit of a conversation prior to me diving into the interview questions. And I didn't want to discard it because I think we're sharing some insightful stuff here. So I wanted to attach that to the interview as well, but I didn't want to put it at the beginning. So if you're interested in checking that out, then keep watching and you'll see that part of the interview.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Your hair got so long.
It's crazy because I was listening to our last interview and I'm like, 2 years ago?
Was so it 2 years? Yeah, that was before you had your last baby.
Yes 2 years ago. He's two now, and I my hair was so short. I was like, oh,
I love it. I love it. I you know, I'm really only on Instagram, and you're not on Instagram a lot. Mm-hmm. But I know you're have like a great YouTube account going, but I don't check in a whole lot. So I was checking on yours too, and I was like, wait a minute, are you no longer You're no longer flushing? Is that right?
No, it's so rare that it happens at all. We moved out of state. We left Tennessee and moved to South Carolina. And I have been working, you know, I think the last time you and I talked, I was like, my goal is to like leave corporate America. And I just don't want to be in these like toxic environments. Well, I was working for a software development company over the past 2 years, and they are just fantastic. And the most healing environment. I oversee our talent culture side of things. So they're like, you do for everybody what you feel that this company did for you. You know, people come in, they're really abused from the environments around them. And we want to let people be safe and then decompress and then build back up and get into a place of creativity and authenticity. And like, who knew at a software development company that we could do that? So it's been awesome.
And then just like work on yourself, right? Of like not getting yourself emotionally worked up. Do you feel like that's part of it as well?
Yeah, I think that so much of my situation came from the authoritative environments of feeling just not good enough. And once we moved to South Carolina, it was like this huge like consciousness shift and like awakening that I feel like I had like this deep layer of leaving my homeland and being able to operate as who I am now and not feel like held back by these invisible strings and threads of like elementary school and middle school.
I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah. But
when you have that shift, it's like life changing. Yeah,
it is. And I was going to this like, so I work remote, but my company is actually located here in South Carolina. So, and I can go be with our leadership team at any time. We've gone out to lunch and dinner and had some in-person moments together, but they all know about Blushing Phoenix. They know that I was on a journey of healing. Right. I had a very direct conversation with my CEO about how I would try to avoid him, because even though I know he is a nice, kind person, CEOs are not nice, kind people, and they are very damaging. And so I was like, I realize that that's not a you problem. That's a me problem, but I want you to help me by me interacting with you and me going through all of this like trauma triggers inside of my body so that my body can learn that this is safe. And he's like, let's do it. And
I'm so happy for you. And honestly, like we can hopefully talk about this on the, you're recording now, but but I also feel like you said like, it's so rare. And when I first healed rosacea, everyone was like, it's not possible. It never happens. Like you're the first person this has ever happened to. And now there's like thousands and thousands of people. So it's not like, it's just that people don't know. And I mean, it may be similar for you. Like once people are aware and then they take these active steps, like, who knows? Like, maybe they're not looking at a lifetime of hiding out and medications and surgeries and all the things that you were even exploring, right?
Yeah. And I got to the place too, where I was like, it's not even about not turning red anymore. It's just about continuing to live my life. And somewhere on that journey, I noticed that the flushing had stopped, and it will still happen from time to time, depending on like environmental things, but it's not this, it's not from this deep psychological wound of lacking of self-worth. And that feels so elementary to me, to think that I didn't have self-worth or that I was super self-conscious, because in my mind, lacking self-worth and being self-conscious looks a certain way. And I am not that look. I'm very like out there in your face.
Yes. But
to know that that's truly what the root was, is that it's a deep-rooted fear of not receiving the approval from the environment around me. Because if I am not approved or I say something that's out of place, a lot of it was like healing, and realizing how often I had repressed my voice, which I found very interesting, because that's where my flushing would happen, is up my neck and chest. And really digging into why am I doing that? And that was, and I'm very vocal. So I'm like, well, I'm not repressing anything, but I am, I don't want to cause a disturbance. I don't want to create friction with people. And that came back from just like a deep childhood wound of a belief when I was a kid that if I am disruptive, if I create an issue with the people around me, then I will be discarded from the group. And if I'm discarded from the group, I'll die. Yeah. And that's like, that's ridiculous. So when you spend time with it, you're like, that's not true.
It's so fascinating. I read this quote a few years ago, and it was about like, healing is actually like letting go of all the beliefs that are not yours. And I was like, oh my gosh, like, could that be true? Like, could I have like, here, you know, your purest soul is like your little 2-year-old self when you're full of life and you don't have any of those fears. And then as we age and we want to please people, we adopt all these beliefs, not intentionally, but just thinking that you're supposed to believe what your parents believe and you're supposed to, you know, fit in and not make waves. And by the time you're 30, you're just this mass of other people's beliefs, right? Yeah. And then undoing it all, like that's what I spent the last, you know, 3 or 4 years was like realizing what was truly me and what was beliefs that I felt like I should have. And then it's like, when you can undo all that and get to who you are, that's when the magic happens.
Yeah. And it's like a dissecting, because I even see this with my 2-year-old, how we are conditioning him with good job or, oh, we got to go potty, you know, like helping to condition him for natural human growth. Right. And you don't realize that, you know, as a kid, you are performing. It's constantly good job, good job, good job.
Yeah,
and even when parents don't mean anything by that, they really are just validating you in your growth.
Right.
But then we realize, well, this gets this reaction from mom and this gets this reaction from mom when I do this thing. And so it's kind of that good, bad factor and just how we process that in our bodies as well. So I think that for flushers and blushers specifically, I think that we always kind of look at, and this is the same with rosacea as well. I think we look at it like, let's address the redness. Let's get to the redness. I want to hide the redness. I want to get rid of the redness.
Yeah. What can I put on my skin to hide it? And so that I can cover it and hide it and pretend it's not there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And all the while it's still there. Okay. So it's like it's
getting worse, thing. Getting progressively worse.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, rise up, rise up. Crowd gets rough, gotta stand up straight, gonna rise like a champion.